Hello and welcome in this talk about the Julia packages of the organization JuliaMusic. My name is George Datseris and I will be talking about how these packages work and how I use them to make science and also how I use them in my personal life as a musician. Before we start the talk, quick disclaimer, because this is a programming conference, however, this talk will not be 100% about programming. In fact, only one third of the talk will be about the Julia language. The other one third would be about the science I do with it. And the other third is about how I use it to have some fun. So without further ado, let's start. And I think it's nice to introduce and motivate why one would do science regarding music. And I always open my talks with this clip, so let's hear it. So this was the Czech Korea band playing Spain. And now you just heard this clip, and now I am asking you to think about what is music. So how would you answer this question? And if you are an artist, then well, first of all, you would say that this is something super awesome. And I think this is true regardless of your preference about music. But it is also some powerful means of expression, and it is also an integral part of human culture since the dawn of civilization. Now, if you are a scientist, you would say, well, this process is ridiculously complicated. And there are so many factors and interacting components in this process that we call music that makes it so complicated. And in the most complex part is that everything happens in real time. So it's some kind of self-organizing process. Now, I'm both a drummer but also a physicist. So the way I approach music is as follows. I want to identify, quantify, and understand the underlying mathematical properties of this wonderful process. And I use Julia to make this possible. So let's think about what music is composed of. And here I have a simple music score of a bass instrument playing. And the scientific approach is to typically throw away as much detail as possible. So when you look at this and you throw away all of these details, then you conclude that music is in fact just notes, lots and lots of notes played in sequence. And a note can be quantified exactly, and of course exactly means that you throw away all the detail. So you need four numbers: the global position of the note, so where it is played, its duration, how long it will last, its pitch, so which frequency should the player play, and its intensity, so how strongly you should play a note. By the way, I will be referring to intensity as velocity. So if you think about this, then you realize, oh, okay, so the fundamental music information, well, I can just describe it by a simple Julia struct, and that's it. This is in fact what we use in Julia music, and it represents fundamental music information. All right, so if you go back to the original question, what is music, and you want the poor man's version of it, well, you know, music is actually just a stream of notes. And in fact, this is what the MIDI format represents. MIDI stands for Musical Instrument Digital Interface, and it is a protocol for sharing music information across the computers. So the problem with this format, which is the widely accepted format, is that it is not human readable. In fact, if you go into the representation of MIDI on a computer, it is literally gibberish. You cannot understand what it means. So you need to do a huge amount of processing to get the MIDI format into some kind of human representation. And this is in fact what the MIDI.jl package does. Allows for easy human-readable input-output of MIDI data. So let me give you, sorry. And of course, within this framework, music is in fact just a vector of these note types, which I will call nodes. All right? So nodes is just a vector of this nice struct. So let me show you how it works in practice. So you have, let's say, some kind of MIDI recording, which I call doxy. And you just load the Julia package MIDI, and then you read this MIDI file. This creates a Julia representation of the MIDI file. And remember, the MIDI file contains the music information in this fundamental level of only having position, velocity, intensity, and duration. Sorry, pitch, velocity, and duration. So once you load this nice MIDI file, Julia says, okay, you have a bunch of tracks here, like a track for the drums and the track for the bass and so on. And then you use this amazing function that is called getNotes. And this function will go into the MIDI file, do all the processing necessary, and will create for you a vector of notes that you see here. So you see every note is very well represented for a human with a specific pitch, a velocity, position, and duration. By the way, I was not the one that created MIDI.jl. I simply started maintaining it and expanding it. So the original creator is Joel Hobson. So Joel, if you ever see this talk, my friend, you absolutely rock. Thank you. All right, so this is how it works. So now that you have a means to get a human readable form of music information, well, now you can actually do science. So in this part of this talk, I want to talk about universal properties of music time series, which is what I'm doing research on. So first, let's define what time series means. Every aspect of notes can provide a time series. So you can have a time series of when exactly is each note played. You can have a time series of which note is played at which time point, or you can have a time series of how strongly is each note played at each time point. For example, if we go into the literature, something that people have researched a lot is what is called microtiming deviations. So imagine for a moment that you have a human, and a human is listening a metronome and is trying to follow the metronome, is trying to play along with the metronome. And of course, the metronome is perfect, but the human is not perfect. So it will have small deviations from the metronome. And here you can see the human notes and the metronome, and you can measure these deviations, these temporal deviations of the human played note from the metronome. And these temporal deviations is in fact what we call microtiming deviations. So if you gather all of them and put them in order, then you have a time series of these so-called microtiming deviations. That looks like this. All right. Now one has to be a bit careful. Because unfortunately, just doing this extremely simple thing of just getting the note position and the note velocity and plotting them with each other is in fact not enough. It is not good enough. And the main reason it is not good enough is because music is a structured process. It is structured on top of a grid, a well-defined grid. And this grid is what you see here. So you have a music bar. And a music bar is typically composed out of four-quarter notes or three-quarter notes. Does not matter that much. But you want to preserve this information. And in fact, the quarter note itself is typically subdivided into another unit. For example, eighth note triplets, which is what you see over here. Here. So you want to preserve this information. This information is crucial. And the way you do this is you use the Julia package music manipulations. Because this package makes this process of getting this time series really, really easy. In fact, you can do this with a single function called time series. And to my knowledge, this function does not exist in other programming languages. So the way this works is that you give this function your notes, like the vector of notes, and the property you want the time series for. And you also define the grid. So the grid I define here is actually representing the 16th notes. I'm not going to go into too many details because, of course, everything is very well documented online. But long story made short is that once you do this kind of a function call, then you have this nice time series where you have two important points. First, the time is now an equispaced, regular, continuous grid that represents or reflects the actual music grid that the performance is based on. And of course, at some points in the grid, the performer does not play. And there you get the value missing in these time series. So this is very important and makes the analysis really, really, really straightforward. Okay, so what does this analysis yield? So the first scientific analysis of this time series was about the microtiming deviations, and people analyzed very simple time series. And the analysis goes as follows. You record some person playing, let's say, some percussion or some drum or doing something else. And then you can either do audio processing, or if you have MIDI data, you use the Julia packets, and you can get the microtiming deviations, which are defined exactly as I described a couple of slides ago. Then, once you have the microtiming deviations, you immediately get the time series of the microtiming deviations. And then, what you do is you do a power spectral density analysis. And what you find once you do the power spectral density analysis is that the power spectrum in fact behaves as a power law function of the frequency. Now the main result is that this is something consistent. So this research has analyzed vocals, drums, percussion and other things. However, they analyzed kind of a trivial setting where people were just playing quarter notes and trying to follow a metronome. So it was not real music, it was just playing quarter notes. And another thing to keep in mind is that this research started the hypothesis that this kind of special structure that our timing fluctuations have actually are what makes music pleasant for humans. We'll see about that. But of course, it goes well beyond this trivial quarter note recordings. So a follow-up study analyzed 100 original rock and jazz recordings, so real music, following the same pipeline of extracting the timings and defining the microtiming deviations, and then making these power spectral density estimates. And the main result is that these timing fluctuation power laws are in fact universal. So they exist in real music, they exist in diverse styles of music, and they exist in different players or instruments. So if you are a bit familiar with the power spectral densities, what this means is that the fluctuations of the human timings are not white noise, but instead correlated noise, like pink noise or red noise. But I don't want to go into too many details in this brief talk. Of course, it gets even more universal because if you look at other time series, not just the timing fluctuation time series, but the velocity fluctuation time series. And remember, velocity is intensity. Then you find again the same power loss. Once again, I will not go into too many details, but this result is also universal. So we have found this result for drums, piano, rock music, jazz music, you name it. So it is, for me, this is extremely fascinating. So if you think about it, isn't it crazy that you find such universal behavior? Because, okay, music is not noise, it is a well-planned process, but every artist is unique and every piece is unique and you can tell them apart very easily. But if you go into the fundamentals of what are the mathematical properties of music, you really find this amazing universality all over the place. And for me, this is truly fascinating. But now it's time to ask a more real question, which says, okay, you have this nice universality, but does it mean anything for humans? Does it actually mean something? And the reason you ask this question is because in the literature, people debate heavily that the fact that the human timing follows this special power law structure is what makes humans music special. This is why we humans really prefer human music over computer music. This is what has been debated in the literature, but there were no evidence for it though. So we came up with a straightforward research project to confirm or disprove this hypothesis. And the way it works is as follows. We recorded a professional pianist playing jazz standards in our institute. And then we manipulated his recordings to remove or alter the microtiming deviation structure. And finally, we asked professional jazz musicians what is best, which version is better. And what we asked them is actually, does it swing or how much it swings? And this is just a proxy for how much pleasant a piece is within the jazz framework. So let me give you an example of a recording. So how do you actually manipulate these microtiming deviations? Well, every played note has a specific distance from the nearest grid point, okay? So this line is the grid point. Every note has some distance, di. So these are the microtiming deviations. You can do something simple. For example, you can exaggerate the microtiming deviations. So for every deviation, you multiply it by 2, and you get twice as much deviation. Or you can quantize them. So quantization is a process well known in the music industry, which removes timing fluctuations completely and makes all notes fall into the grid point, which is the same as multiplying the deviations with 0, of course. Or you can invert them, which means that you multiply them with -1. So if you were playing ahead of the beat, you now play behind the beat. So what I really want to highlight is how easy it is to make this in Julia at the moment. If you use the package music manipulations, these 10 lines of code do exactly this process that I described. They take some notes and they define the microtiming deviations and they manipulate them and they save the manipulated track. So I'm not kidding you, this 10 lines of code is quite literally 1/4 of this paper. To be fair, it took me 6 months to actually create this library. But now this library exists, so people can do this really, really easily. Okay, so I want to quickly highlight the main result of our research, which says that, in fact, these microtiming deviations and their special structure does not, in fact, increase pleasantness in any way. And if anything, it decreases it. And this is what is highlighted in this plot, where people rated higher, in general, recordings that had been quantized. And of course, quantization completely removes the power law structure of our timing fluctuations. Now, important point, this does not mean that computers are better at making music. Of course not. It just means that we prefer the expectance factor you get from playing accurately. And that is it, pretty much. So before going into the fun stuff, I want to quickly highlight the research I am currently doing, and it is research about the synchronization between musicians. So what I want to know is how people synchronize with each other, how well they synchronize, and more specifically, what affects how well we synchronize. And what I'm showing over here is a plot of a live performance of the piece Cantaloupe Island that I played with my band. And excuse me. This kind of music visualization is called piano roll, and if you're familiar with digital audio workstations like Cubase, you probably have seen this form of visualizing music. And in fact, this comes from our own Julia packets music visualizations. Now, what I have to create for my research project is an algorithm that can estimate and extract the beat. So when is the perceived point in time that the musician will play? I keep in mind this is recording without metronome, so I have to estimate this exclusively from the music performance. And in fact, I have done this and I will soon publish it in Music Manipulations, but I just want to test it a bit and fine-tune some details. And now I want to say why doing science in Julia is truly awesome. And the reason is that there are many, many reasons, but one of the reasons is that many young scientists and research groups use Julia. And the benefit is that they actually publish their latest algorithms. So the latest research you get, you immediately publish it. For example, I just showed this beat detection algorithm. Well, I will publish it even before my paper is published. And the other reason that it is awesome is that inter-package communication and interaction is just pure magic in Julia. It is so straightforward to do everything. For example, in this research project about synchronization between musicians, one of the main ways I measure synchronization is using the transfer entropy. It is a quantity, we don't have to go into too many details, but there is a Julia package for this transfer entropy. And in fact, calculating the transfer entropy between The drums and the piano is as straightforward as just calling a single function called transfer entropy, just like that. And of course, the person that is writing this Julia package, Christian Haga, is doing research on estimating the transfer entropy. So here you really get cutting-edge algorithms to estimate this from the group's research. So I think this is super cool. Right. And now for the last four slides, I want to quickly say how I use the packages of JuliaMusic to make myself a better drummer. Yeah, that is very true. So the way playing drums works is that you don't have a predefined melody that you have to learn and memorize and perform exactly. Instead, you have to understand how to play patterns and improvise on the spot and combine patterns arbitrarily when you play music. So what I have here is a simple example. I have these four patterns that I want to learn, and I want to be able to combine arbitrarily on the spot without thinking about it. So my first step is to actually define these patterns using music manipulations and MIDI. So I am defining these patterns as notes, and remember, this is what a note means. And now what I do is I use the Julia package motif sequence generator, which provides this nice function. And what this nice function does is it combines these random motifs. So remember, these are the random motifs. And they are combined in a random way, but they are combined in a way that they respect music requirements. For example, that they fill exactly 8 bars or exactly 4 bars. And in addition, music manipulations also allows you to add text annotation to the music notes that you create. So if you add this text annotation, sorry, annotation, you can call MuseScore. MuseScore is an open source music score editor and creator, and we have interfaced this. So calling simply the function MuseScore and giving this function the Julia notes, the vector of these notes, will create for you automatically this nice score. And you don't have to worry about anything, about any opening GUIs, about configuring stuff. This is literally created by putting notes and calling MuseScore. So this is really straightforward. And then I take this to the drum set and I practice the crap out of it. Now, another example is making this kind of representation. Instead of having a score, sometimes it is very useful to have a matrix. And why is this useful? Because what you want to be able to do is to combine any pattern from the rows with any pattern from the columns. So you somehow go through this matrix and see if you can tick every box. So let me give you an example of how these patterns sound like from one of my own performances. So I kid you not, I have been studying this matrix for about 2 months, non-stop, every day. So you can tell I'm pretty proud of the result. All right, so and now we go to the final slide, pretty much. So once I made these simple exercises, I shared them with a drums educator that makes YouTube videos called Austin. And Austin has this amazing, mind-blowing series called Study the Greats. So Austin told me that this is pretty cool, but he also told me the truth that if you are not a programmer, it's very difficult to use this kind of stuff. So his idea is to make an Android or smartphone app where it offers permutations. For example, you give a standard pattern and the app permutates, let's say, the bass drum. What I have in mind is something a bit more general. So you start with a choice of notes or patterns, and then you give the app some restrictions. For example, the first note is always the note K, the last note is never the note A, or you never have the same note more than 2 times in a row. And then the app generates for you these permutations that satisfy these restrictions on the fly. I actually have a working prototype for making this, but I have no knowledge about apps or creating Android apps. So this is my call for help. If you have any experience with making apps, please consider joining us and helping us make this nice thing. And in general, if you are a musician that wants to play around with these things, consider joining our organization because we would really appreciate having some more, let's say, manpower. And you can find us on Slack or on GitHub. So with this, I would like to thank you for your attention and of course, thank all of my collaborators in these science projects. Ah, and if you want the slides, just tell me.